Hello, everyone. Thank you for sticking around. It's the final panel talk today here for True Music with Ballantine's and Boiler Room. And we're going to talk today about the role of artists in 2017 and how artists and their art do or do not have a responsibility. Now, coming from a time where I remember growing up as an artist signed to a label, you could get dropped by a label if you challenged community or showed your political views, to being now living in a time and being part of a DIY generation where we create our own institutions and our own networks and our own frameworks built off of our moral, political, and social beliefs, artists and the music industry has come a very long way. Now, what we're going to talk about today is we're going to talk about the current role of artists in the context of community and whether artists should or should not have any moral responsibility. We're going to talk about cool versus consciousness. We're going to discuss art, activism, and identity. And then we're going to close it off talking about building coalitions within the DIY generation and how this culture is going to move forward. Now, we've invited five panelists who all in their own way have stepped up and have become part of this conversation that we're having today through their work and experience. And they really have a legitimate and unique opinion on this topic. And I will let you introduce yourself. If you want to briefly say who you are, what you do, and why we would have invited you to be part of this discussion today. Grant, you can start.
Hello, everyone. Yeah, my name's Grant Fleming. I'm a photographer and filmmaker now. I started out as a musician within the music, you'd say, industry, but during punk days, I mean, it goes back a long way. But then going through Acid House in London, putting on parties, moving over to DJing, and then becoming a photographer more for the back of the political movements that were happening in the UK in the 80s and 90s. And now I photograph that same scene, but also cover politics. But they've always been hand in hand to me from the word go. Obviously from starting with punk, where that was motivated by social politics to this very day.
Hi, my name is Lafawndah. I'm a musician, producer, singer. I guess the reason why I was invited today, maybe, is that I think about music as a toolbox that can be exchanged between the person who makes the music and the people who receive it. And I think about the kind of ideas and energies that I want to put out in the world with my music, and I talk about it quite a lot, so that's probably why, yeah.
Hello, my name's GAIKA. I make art in different forms. I make music, film, a DJ, do various things. I think I was invited here today because I talk quite a lot of smack on the internet, quite a lot of the time. So that is the only reason that I can see.
Hello, hi, I'm Kojey Radical, and I write poems and make art and stuff. I'm a musician from East London. I got into like making music about 3-4 years ago. And kind of use that as a tool to express myself through different mediums, so film, kind of contemporary dance, and my background is in painting and illustration, so it kind of covers across the board, but I don't know why Jyoty got me here. I think it's because I speak a lot like GAIKA, but we'll see what happens today.
You'll all find out as the panel goes along why they've been invited here. Louisahhh, go ahead.
Hi, I'm Louisahhh. I'm a DJ, producer, vocalist, and now label boss of a label called RAR, and I try and make intentionally disruptive art. So thanks for having us.
Thanks for being here, all you guys. And let's just get straight into it. Why are we having this conversation now, and why today, part of the True Music Forum here in Poland? Why is it relevant? As we've all discussed one-on-one before, the topics of politics and economics and social responsibility or inequality the problems have all been discussed and we are aware of this, but what we're trying to get to today is moving beyond just the problem, but what we're capable of and what we're a part of. So why do you think we're having this conversation today?
Direct eye contact, hi. So I think that this is a really interesting time to have this conversation, because I'm not sure if ever in history have artists had so much access to an actual dialogue, a direct conversation with fans, and in an opportunity to kind of create a tribe around that platform of one's beliefs, either sociopolitically or in terms of making meaningful work. And also, we talked, you introduced us discussing kind of a DIY manner of release, that no longer do we have to rely on major labels or really any labels to release music, and the music business or the business of entertainment is a totally different game. And so this idea of making a decision and perhaps a statement with one's work of whether we are artists or whether we are entertainers, are we making work to please a crowd, or are we making work to scratch an itch that is not necessarily going to be pleasing to everybody, is a question that we get to kind of play with, I think, more openly these days, and then kind of have a feedback loop and an open conversation with our tribe about it.
GAIKA.
I think that art deals directly with emotion, with how people feel, and how people feel dictates what they do. I think that humanity is in a fight for survival. I feel like as a human, it's my responsibility to my own existence, to the world, to try and do something that is positive. I feel that, and I'm not in any way sort of, I don't feel weird about it. I don't feel slightly ashamed or whatever. So I feel like, yeah, I want to use what's inside my head and heart to try for the betterment of our society, and I want to shout about that with no stops, really.
I guess for me, what's interesting in the question is, I think that historically, when we think about music and social responsibility, it's been actually quite like that for a very long time. And I think that we just happen to be around at a time where it stopped being like that, but I think it was an exception. We're just coming back to something that has always been the case. We have other means, I think now we have access to directness, which is a very new thing. But to me, the question of entertainment and versus responsibility is kind of fraught, at least for me. I don't think about it in those terms. I can tell you so many examples of people around the world who were major popular figures, who were on TV, that everybody was listening to. It had, you know, was kind of above class and economic status, that were pop figures of their time, who were, you know, addressing, just reflecting and addressing a lot of things in many subtle and unsubtle ways. So to me, there's nothing new in the time that we're in. We're just, we were in a really cynical parenthesis for a while of, I don't know, it was felt quite cynical. And we're just going back to how it's always been. I don't feel the need to label that in a particular way. It's just making music. It's always been like that, mostly, for me, at least. That's how I see it.
And what about artists who say, I'm not a role model and I don't try to change the world, I just make tunes for the sake of making tunes? What about those people then? What's the difference there? And how does that relate to art and entertainment?
I'd say good for them, good for those people.
Yeah.
But like, I don't know, like, I don't walk around with my eyes closed. It's as simple as that. Like, I can't ignore the context in which I live, and I can only speak for myself. If that's what you want to do, then fine. But if you hit a wall, then don't come crying to me, you know?
I think the balance comes from the idea of not seeing people or people that create as role models or these people that are above social status or class or whatever, and see them as among and the people that are vocalizing the experiences that we go through every day. Art imitates life, and it is the role of the artist in order to reflect that. And that's why conversations like this are important, because it allows us now to kind of engage in this open forum where we can discuss really what is quite a interesting time that we live in, where everything's very postmodern and it's already existed. There's no such thing as originality anymore. We just recreate in different forms. And with that, a lot of lines get blurred on what's okay, what's not okay, especially as cultures interact and start to integrate and things start to become almost like a hybrid. Yeah, do you know what I mean? So like, eventually there comes a point where you have to reflect what is going on around you. I don't think it necessarily makes you a role model in that case, but you play a role, and if people want to model their actions after you, that's up to them. Do you know what I mean? That's a choice for the consumer rather than the artist per se.
Go ahead.
Yeah, well, I just think from my experience, art and the expression and commentary, social issues through art, have traditionally come from, you'd say, outsiders. And so there was always a feeling that you had to kick down the door. And from my point of view, you know, as a musician, it was to get into a record company, to have your demo tape listened to, or put it on parties in Acid House. It was kicking down warehouse doors to get in. Now there seems to be a kind of almost an acceptance that, you know, things are there, not a complacency, but almost like an ease with which people can achieve things. But I think the doors still need kicking down, but maybe they're, you know, kind of a virtual door now. But the expression needs to be even upped. Given the fact that in our societies, it seems that we seem to be going backwards whilst technology can carry us forwards. And I think that now the fact that we can be connected with like-minded people is a tool that really has to be used now in a way that we never really had that before. You found that you were working as an island. But now it's like, it needs people, good people, to get together, because there's a lot of shit happening, as we can see around us all the time. And like I say, we have the tools now, and we should use them in a stronger way, in a collective way.
Can you explain what you mean when you say we seem to be moving backwards? In what sense do you mean that?
Politically, let's look at, you know, some of the rhetoric that's coming from the leaders of, you know, the Western world. You know, it's not far removed from what you was hearing in Germany in the early 30s, you know. So, you know, that in itself seemed to be more polarization. It's being encouraged in societies, in modern mechanized societies, and in developing countries, maybe less so. But, you know, the fear is that the tools that potentially are so strong that we can use are being used against us too. So we have to look out for that. I mean, you know, I think the internet's a wonderful thing. And I think, you know, the democracy that has given everybody the ability to make music, to make, to take pictures, to make films, is a great thing. But, we really have to think about what we're doing with it, too. It isn't just a game, you know. I mean, if you want to treat it as a toy, that's fine. As an individual, I don't think of it like that. I think there's actually a lot we can achieve with it.
Amazing. Getting straight in, is this a trend? Are we part of a trend? Why, the funny you just said we had a moment, we're going back to how things always were. There was a 10, maybe 15 years where, you know, it was a bit silent, not so much, I don't want to use the word, but let's say activism, or maybe it wasn't that visible. Now, it's everywhere you look. It's becoming part of campaigns, of everyday conversation, online, social media posts, to get as many likes as you can. Where's the fine line between being genuine and trying to make a change and trying to stand for something, or being part of a trend?
I think that the way that you make it, sorry, that you make the difference, and it's something I've noticed quite a lot in the past couple of years, is the, let's define also what we say when we say that people should be concerned, or like the responsibility, because I think that there is ways where in which people operate in a very loud way, and that feels fraud. But I think that the way that you know that something is not fraud is also because there's many ways to express your alignment or your ethics. It's not, you don't, some people come and they just, you know, I don't know, be the Black Panther at the Super Bowl, that's one way, but there's also many other silent ways of doing something, and that's something that you can learn about an artist when you start scratching, like, who are they working with? If you make some announcement about your ethical values and then I scratch and I see that everyone you're working with is a white man, maybe that's fraud, you know what I mean? And there's many ways, I think, that people don't, to me, being socially responsible also doesn't have to be with just like wearing it on your forehead. It also has to do with your everyday politics, who you decide to give power to, who's your manager, how are you dealing, what are your relationship with your label, who do you share your platform with, who do you decide that's gonna talk on your behalf, all of these things that are not appearing necessarily, but that to me are like the actually how change operates, much more than screaming out loud that like I'm anti this, or you know what I mean? So that to me is also the way that I would make the difference if I see an alignment in someone, the way that they operate. If you don't get splashed in the mirage of whatever, you know what I mean? Like if you're looking, if you're like interested in artists and you see how they operate, you'll find out quite right away if it's like something that is genuine, I think.
Yeah, no, I feel you. I feel like in regards to like the idea of it being a trend and all that kind of stuff, it does depend on the context in which you speak of. Because like, for example, yes, it is a growing, I don't want to, because the word trend to me implies people just do it for the sake of popularity. And there are, it is definitely growing in popularity too. Sorry. The drinks got to me. It's more popular to like be outspoken now, because obviously there's so much more going on that if you're not outspoken, it kind of feels like you're just one of the sheep, you're kind of following the trend. But with that, it kind of depends on how you use that outspokenness, and if it is truly effective. Sometimes, because there is one specific conversation going on, a lot of people want to get behind that conversation. I'll give an example. There was like a massive lack of, let's say, female energy in a lot of departments, especially when it comes to music. Do you know what I mean? And then there was a rise of like, okay, girls are going to take power. We're going to be like, yo, we're going to make stuff for girls. But then you'll create these platforms and only pick other girls with followers. Or, do you know what I mean? Instead of actually open it up for like people to kind of come along and gain experience and actually create a whole new industry where you can build upon it, the trend becomes, okay, cool, we're going to act like we're doing this kind of like, oh, everyone's for this one cause, but we're only going to get people that can, do you know what I mean? That have already have a social media following, or already have this, or already have that. And then what it then starts to do is make people feel alienated from the process of feeling like they can either get involved in something or speak out against something or blah, 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 because they feel like their voice isn't big enough. They don't have a big enough platform to say anything in the first place. I think a big goal for, like, I guess, because it's weird. Artists are going to do what artists do, innit? But, like, a positive way to kind of move forward with it all is this idea of actually, like, it's almost like an each one teach one kind of situation. Do you know what I mean? Like, we gain knowledge, we gain experiences through life and how we choose to live it and things that we go through it. But how we then decide to relay that experience is really the deciding factor on whether it is a trend or it's not. Because those kind of things can come and go very quickly. But reality is, it's in aid of us. it's in aid of actually kind of creating more opportunities, creating more platforms, creating more diversity across the board, and not in this kind of like token select, okay, we'll just have one of each, but actually opening up things past what it is in terms of just like, okay, cool, like skin color, gender, sexuality or whatever it is, and actually going down to like, what is your intent as an artist? What is the basis of your skill? Like, how well do you want to now translate that and put that forward, and what ways are you going to do that? And remove everything else from it, everything else that can now be categorized as like, oh, we're going to get this person for this, we're going to get this person for that, we're just going to get people for actually what they do. I think now is when we should be moving into an age of intent. Say it and do it. Do you know what I mean? Be about what you say. Do you know what I mean? Instead of just acting because of social media, I guess.
But, and I also think that it's interesting that you're asking us this question, because maybe some of us, at least me, it's also, when you're like asking if it's a trend, I think we're also on the receiving end of that as musicians, whatever minority we are. And it's very jarring to have to deal with that on a regular day-to-day experience as a musician, because you're always like, why do you want me? Why are you calling me? Do you like me? Like, it's, you know, there's never a situation in which I am where I can just be guards off and be like, I think I'm here because my music's great.
So you're looking,
you know what I mean? Like, there is
ulterior motives.
Huh?
So you question the motive behind.
Of course, we all do. I mean, everyone who's a minority, whatever it is, you know what I mean? Whatever that is not a white straight man in power, everyone else is always questioning why they, what's their place, why they've been invited, what is the intention, always. So the trend that you're talking about is actually something that we are dealing with on the receiving end of it. And the reason why it is, the difference for me between something being a trend and something being a real change is that if you have the same chain of command, if you have the same people making the decision, but suddenly deciding that something is cool, that is not a profound change. So if I have the same people that have been in power since probably the last 20 years, same people who suddenly decide that they wanna reshape the image of their label, and we are part, all of us, of this reshaping, you know, and it's something that we find out afterwards. We were like, oh, great, well, you want to work with us? And then we find out that suddenly there is like, you know, 10 artists of color, and like, you know, they were just literally like part of a lifting of the thing. It still is the same person making this decision of who needs to have a platform and who does not. And that's...
Exactly.
It's like a loop. We're in a loop.
I think, I really agree. I think that personally, I can answer it pretty succinctly. I think that activism at this present moment is a trend directly because, as you say, like, what's actually changed? You know, it's like a mask that people can wear to say, okay, well, this is the cool thing now. How do we commodify this? How do we make money from this guy? Because he's got a big mouth. He's going to talk about this stuff. So how do we neuter him by making it a trend? My thing is, but so what? If we're smart, we can use that thing, because real change happens by minds changing or with force of arms. So if I look at it this way, I'm either out in the street or I'm a propagandist. I don't want to shoot anyone, so I'm out here essentially trying to make what I believe actually something that people might take a small kernel of it because it's the cool thing. And you know what, the resources that come my way, I'm gonna use it to execute actual change, which is an economic thing, which is to do with the motion of power. It is not to do with what anyone says on social media. So yeah, I think it's a trend, but it's a trend that's better than greed and stupidity. And for as artists, if we are part of that, then we just got to box clever and actually use it to attempt to do something. If you look at like grime, right? And everybody wrote off grime for Corbyn as a trend, as a joke, until all the man them came off the blocks and voted. And no one thought that was gonna happen. Do you know what I mean? I went home to vote, and I was looking at it like, okay, all these guys have gone and voted, and I know that this is something to do with Stormzy, this is something to do with Novelist. So it started as a kind of, it might have been a hype, but the net result was this. Hip hop started off, you know, like, okay, Jay-Z is talking about money and he's talking about cars and he's talking about this, but then at some point, there's power in that. So yeah, that's what I think.
Well, I was saying earlier about, you know, what I'd witnessed in the Gambia earlier this year, and literally a people's movement rose against a dictator, came together under a hashtag that someone put together, and basically everyone rallied under this Gambia has decided slogan. And that's where somewhere you can say, well, social media did, you know, actually effect change, because maybe previously in the 22 years before that dictator was chased away, people felt singular, they felt scared. They, you know, they knew that everybody together didn't want this guy, but felt weak. And suddenly this thing and social media playing a part in a very strong way, I think gave people strength, drew them together as a rallying call, and suddenly there was change. So, you know, the whole thing in itself, it's the first generation, I guess, we're going through this as a platform. And so it's a learning curve for everyone, right? And a lot of good and a lot of bad. But certainly, you know, I haven't given up on the idea that, you know, it really can. And I think that's a really good point, that what we saw, you know, in that last election. An absolute, you know, nailed on victory for one party. Suddenly was put under question. And that really was the motivation. That was a catalyst for it, that change.
Taking what each and every one of you have just said, and taking that into the next question, and I want everyone to just be really honest. When we talk about trends, don't laugh. When we talk about trends, and what I'm trying to say is marketable. Now, we know, we've discussed that the intentions, especially if everyone on this panel is genuine and they stand for something. As an outsider, as a fan of music, or someone who just watches the telly or sees advertisement, to see big corporations now stand for social issues and using artists to campaign this, where do you think, and is there even a line to be drawn? Where do you draw the line of adding something of content to what they're trying to campaign, and then on the other spectrum, a term I don't like to use, being a sellout?
It's chess, isn't it? Yeah. Nah, it's chess.
Go on.
Let me tell you why it's chess, yeah. Because corporations aren't just like, they're not super nice guys sitting in a room waiting for you to say what you feel, because they don't care how you feel. Like, you have to be on the inside in order to understand it and actually make differences. This is exactly what GAIKA was saying. It's like, yeah, cool. Boom, it might be a trend to get people that speak out involved. But once you've got them involved, you have to be prepared for them to speak out. And I think it's definitely how you choose to use said platforms. Because, again, like, we live in an age where it's like, my man down the street could have the answer to solve, like, the world's problems. We're not going to listen to him because he's just my man from down the street. Do you get me? Like, he has to go through stages for us to even turn around and go, oh, maybe you have a point, despite the fact his point might not have changed since he started. Do you know what I mean? So it's using these things to your advantage. It's a game of chess. Like, I see certain things and I think to myself, right, did my man sell out? And then, like, depending on their movements then on afterwards, you actually go, actually, wait, no, he didn't. Like, a great example of it is Stormzy. Is like, Stormzy's done so much in terms of, like, major corporation campaign kind of, like, things. He's done a lot. But he's never let any of that stop him from being himself. And there's a difference between, like, okay, cool, now let's say I'm working with Adidas, and Adidas has handed me a mic, like, boom, I could take that mic and be like, fuck Theresa May, but it's not going to do nothing. Do you know what I mean? They're just going to press the mute button and move on. It's those things that cause people to look at me, and then how I choose to now reflect myself in my day-to-day is the difference between, like, okay, is this person a sellout or is this person actually playing the game, like, properly? I don't know. Maybe that's just me. But
I mean, I think also the question of, like, who I'm willing to take money from, are they in line with my integrity? Like Lafawndah was saying earlier about, like, not only, like, scratching and, like, getting interested in who our heroes are and what they actually stand behind, who backs them, but also in terms of, like, the reason we get to make work as artists in a lot of ways is because corporate sponsorship. I mean, like, hello. So
let's talk about it.
So it's
let's talk,
like,
about it.
Is this in line with my, like, will I have to change my message to appease whoever's giving me money? If not, like, do their corporate values stand in line with my integrity as an artist? And I mean, I think it's just, like, not only artists, but people in general, like, the public at large, we do have power in what we buy, you know? We have power in who we let represent us, or who we allow us to give us money. And so to kind of make wise decisions with integrity there, and perhaps because we do have a platform, get vocal about it, you know? Like, why, if we don't let somebody pay us, or if we don't agree to take a deal, why? And hopefully having a tribe of fans or a community that is built around us, allow the, like, social media platforms as a dialogue and a space of education, so we get to ask and answer questions, you know? It's more of a two-way dialogue, and we have, like, more kind of constant feedback and also constant ability to, like, send messages via whatever, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, to fans, and, like, it can create a really exciting, disruptive space. Like, it's incredible, but it's also, if I'm not paying attention, it can be dangerous.
The thing is, I don't understand admin. I don't know why anybody ever gives me money, really and truly. I think I can't know that. You know, these decisions get made based on statistics that I don't care to even process. All I know is that if I'm in a room and people are going to listen, then I'm going to say what I think matters. You know, and obviously, I'm not going to take money from sources which are completely alien, totally from my worldview. But I think brands or corporations have stepped into a place which maybe in the past either didn't exist or was kind of, it was an infrastructural or governmental responsibility to support the arts. And that, to me, the big question is not really like, oh, by trying to feed ourselves, are we selling out? But, like, why is this even happening? Like, where does the money that we pay in tax go? Yeah. Well, you know, why does so much arts funding go to opera and ballet, and therefore, you know, anyone that is not an opera singer or a ballet dancer ends up sitting on a panel just like this? Because I know that you don't make opera. You're not doing ballet.
You know,
right?
What my next album sounds like.
Exactly. So, but those people have massive amounts of support, really, in terms of the popularity. So then, obviously, brands step in and be like, okay, well, look, how do we use the popularity or use this kind of mysterious cool factor in order to sell our product? Well, okay, they're going to do that. But to me, the bigger conversation is that, why is it just them? And then it then gets thrown back on us. It's like, well, okay, well, all right, man. Like, did you pay for my record, though? Did you pay to come to my show, then? No, you didn't. So what do we do, you know?
I think as artists, we just got to respect ourselves more. Do you get me? Because at the end of the day, it is an exchange. Obviously, there's the side that's the payer. It seems like, okay, they're more powerful. But there is an exchange. There is a reason why these people came to you. And with that, it's like, if you are the type of person that speaks out, that is the type of person that is engaged with a message and blah, 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 don't stop yourself. Do you know what I mean? Don't filter yourself just because you're working with a corporation or whatever. Do what you got to do, whether that's on the stage or off the stage or whatever it is. Do what you got to do, because reality is, whoever is ready to really show their true colors will show their true colors. Do you know what I mean? You could even, for example, the L'Oreal thing with Monroe. Do you know what I mean? She had been on her activism stuff. She had been saying all of this wild stuff about like white supremacy and all that kind of stuff. Like, this wasn't news. Do you know what I mean? But on paper, it's cool. Oh, she's outspoken. Oh, it's this. Oh, it's that. Let's get her involved until she really says some stuff. Then let's ax her, innit? Like, reality is people will just, they'll show their true colors at the end of the day. You just got to respect yourself.
I think the reason why I brought this up is because I wanted you guys to hear from the panelists themselves that it's easy to look at an artist being involved in a campaign and thinking, oh, that's like money involved as a sellout. But let's not forget, we are here because of the sponsorship by Ballantine's, and this gives us the opportunity to not compromise on all these opinions and views. So it goes both ways. There is the higher power with the money, but they need their ideas and their content. And we've come to a time, leading on to the next question before we go to the public, we've come to a time now where we have so much power. You know, your SoundCloud producers, your fashion bloggers on Instagram, they have so much knowledge on what is hot right now that there's an even divide, which creates this amazing DIY culture that we're a part of. Back in the day, you couldn't think about starting your own radio station. Now, you hear it all around. You go into a pub in London, everyone has their own label. Everyone's putting out their own music. Tell us here today how you see this moving forward, and maybe even if you have like advice on how to make the most out of the tools that we have being part of this generation.
Well, just, I mean, overlapping from the previous topic, I mean, it's just a case, I think, of your responsibility just as a human being and your own integrity to the world around you and to, you know, your fellow sharers of this planet, that the decisions you make are based on that. So as an artist, it should be the same. And I think you make your decisions in terms of whether you know, you are dancing with the devil. It's like how much you dance to their tune or not. And we all know that none of us here will, but at the same time, that's a door also that they hold, from sponsorship, can get you a platform where your ideas can be heard. And that's really important because, you know, like I've always said, it's like, it's no good, you know, shouting really loudly outside the door. I mean, no one's listening. You know, you've got to kind of, even if you have to wedge your foot in a little bit and just, like I say, kind of make it work for you. But to get to that point when suddenly you are being heard. And maybe it's a bit by bit and it's a step by step, but we do have the tools. And as we said, the social media, I think, is the greatest possibility. We got to find the way to use it to our ends. Mm. That's the point.
I guess, for me, when I think about the way the economical situation of music right now and what that leads, the way that it leads us to operate, honestly, I don't have, it's not a great news. Like the DIY thing that you're talking about is, I am not magnifying that. Like, I think it's really beautiful in many ways, but I also think it's really sad in a lot of ways. Like, I don't, you know, I just, I don't
Why
think
it
it's sad? Like, huh?
Why is it sad? If you could just explain
because
that.
Because I think that the way that, you know, money is circulating in the music industry and the way that, I mean, the consequences of that is that It's very hard to participate in music right now if you're not coming from money. That's also reality, you know? The way that it works economically, like the things that you're asked to do as an artist, a lot of it, you basically have to pay to participate. That's the reality. So DIY is cute. Like, this is how I make my shit. This is where he makes his shit. Like, it's, this is how we have to do our things, but there's nothing like amazing about that. Me personally, I think, I mean, we make it into the most empowering situation that we can, because there is no choice, but it's not bomb. It's not a great situation, I would say. I don't know if it answers your question, but I wanted to say that.
I mean, I think that DIY is pretty bullshit. I think that the reality, well, I'm definitely engaged in it. I think that ultimately, you know, you talk over a door and it's so difficult to get through that door. So you either sort of like stand there and, you know, jump on the spot until they let you in, or you try and wedge your foot in, or you try and bash it down. To bash it down needs massive resources, which, you know,
the
people,
resources are behind that door. I mean, that's the matter.
Well, this is the thing, you know, massive resources, which essentially, you know, no one ever reports that. So I can only speak for myself. My strategy is to try and amass enough resources so that I can bash it down and try and reach out to other people who we're all in these little militia, these little tribes, and come together and pool our resources so that we can actually run through and pillage the whole shit.
Is that not DIY in a sense?
Yeah, it is.
In
but
modern
like,
day context?
At scale, though. Because,
but it is.
Yeah, but it is. But when we think of DIY, we talk about this connotation of, okay, well, I can just get a webcam and I can just set this up, me and my friends, and then it's all going to be fine. But in terms of music, like, major labels have millions and millions of dollars to pour behind stuff that is fundamentally rubbish. So let's have a real conversation about power. Let's talk about how much money it costs, and let's pool our resources so that we actually make a viable alternative rather than playing the game of like, oh, this is cottage industry, which we can then be, can be further commodified into like cool factor to then reflect back onto what majors and big corporations are doing. Because as far as I'm concerned, big corporations are just peopled by people. It's just staffed by people who are no smarter than me, no smarter than you. And it's just about literally the will to act. You know, who is going to blink first? So it's like, I don't know. Like, I don't know. If you're in a big corporation, you want to give me money, great. But I'm going to definitely try and use that to expand and push you out the way. That's the way I see it.
After that, we're going to go to the questions of the audience.
I mean, while I'm all for, like, gate crashing and kind of breaking the door down, I think, like, the DIY solution, although it does require resources, as has been mentioned, like, is also a way to get to make your work on your terms and also, like, build another door, you know? And I think that, at least for me, the strategy has been, instead of trying to be a lot of things to a lot of people and kind of get the door open for me from the other side, it's been more effective to try and be like what I am to a very few people, and hopefully they tell their five friends and they tell their five friends. So it's not McDonald's, it's like your mom makes a sandwich and hopefully it works out. And yeah, like that, it feels much more precarious than having a big industry behind you, but at the same time, like, I don't necessarily want to make music that is comfortable for, like, that fits into the fundamentally rubbish category that you were talking about, you know?
I think the culture has always been DIY. Like, if you think about the beginnings of any genre, it takes somebody doing it themselves in order to make it anything. What happens is this cherry picking. So there's a massive culture of people doing it themselves, creating this genre, making something popular, making something interesting, and then the label, the corporation, or whatever will come along and go, well, you look special, we'll take you out and leave the rest of the genre behind. And I think that's when it starts to become and start to feel like it's just the whole idea of do it yourself is bullshit. Because realistically, we're all doing it ourselves in order to get the hand from whoever it is that can help us. And I think it's removing that going forward. It's just like saying, okay, if I'm going to do it myself, I'm going to do it myself. Do you know what I mean? And however I play that game in order to do that, is the difference. We're in this weird kind of balancing point where the next generational shift, in my opinion, is going to be
exactly what GAIKA was saying, is that these corporations are people in there, like us, like you and me, working for whoever. Do you know what I mean? But with more dialogue, with more conversation, with more people aware of what's going on and actually understanding that people see completely through it, the shift is going to have to move towards, okay, cool, so how do we now make the culture work for us? And there's a lot more standoffing, if that makes sense. It's very more standoffy. Like, you can't tell me what to do, to think, to make, to create anymore. So now, I feel like the next generational shift is you're going to start to see these bigger corporations, these bigger labels, having to bow to the artists, because the artists can remove themselves from these institutions now and have a lot of success. Mm-hmm. And we're starting to see that with more kind of like, yeah, I use the term loosely, but independent artists having a lot more success by themselves. And you can kind of now remove yourself from this kind of ecosystem and genuinely do it yourself if that's what you want to do. But just on paper, nah, it's nonsense.
I mean, after GAIKA, we're going to go to the audience.
I feel like the kind of old model in a way is already invalid. Like, I've decided to kind of push to create or expand my own infrastructure to a certain scale, and it happened because I saw Ed Sheeran had, what, 9 out of 10 chart positions, and I was like, this is, it's not real, it's not reality. Like, this doesn't reflect anything in my world, and just shows how much something can be manufactured and just like pulled out of thin air, right? And in reality, like, it kind of just spurred me into action rather than just being like an artist and, you know, you get a bit of money and have a cool life. But it's, I feel like something has to be done to kind of like reflect the world that we live in, which is with all of this technology and all of this communication, people have much more varied taste and much more interesting taste in terms of art. So yeah, like whilst I feel that the term DIY has limits, I do believe that the power is with us.
Thank you. Do we have time to go to the audience? Okay. I'm going to do one more question and then we're going to move to the audience. Right. Interesting. Because, GAIKA, earlier today you said something really that made me really happy, and it actually hit the nail on the head about what we're talking about today with artists and their responsibility, whether they have one or not. And you said, I make my art for the purpose of making art. And I want to make it without ever having to compensate on what I want to say and what I want to do. But I'm going to make my living as well. And that's where the...
Oh, yeah. I mean, like, I do that because I have to. You know, I cannot make music that is designed. I can't make music. I can't write lyrics that are, oh, okay, this is going to work. This is going to be on the radio. My mind doesn't work like that. So I don't even try. I just say how I feel in that moment, but I have found that, you know, I'm not in the top 10, right? I'm not out here making a great living out of my raps. So I have to do other things to survive. And I kind of come to this position where it's like, look, art, I think the role of an artist is to make art for art's sake. We have to de-commodify art and just do it to be sick, to be great, to express ourselves, rather than thinking about how we can profit from it. Now, actually, what I actually believe in a like utopian society is the patronage of artists and art because it's beautiful, and, you know, art's paid for because it's beautiful. The commerce of it is this kind of fairly recent and problematic thing. But for now, this is the way it is. So, yeah, like, I got a pizza restaurant. Whatever it takes that I can live my life, and I'm gonna make my art with no sense of like commerciality.
Well, I mean, I think any true artist, not one woke up one day and went, I know a way I can make more money. Because if they did, then they were completely wrong. Because there's a lot easier ways to make money. So I think, you know, you could say for all of us here, we decided to do something because we felt strongly about it. and we had a burning passion about it, or we wanted to say something. And I've got to a point where I just think, well, yeah, like yourself, you know what, if I can pay the bills by other means, whatever I need to do, and that allows me the freedom to say what I want to say, then that's the way forward for me. You know, I don't need the yacht, I don't need the, whatever. But probably there are, you know, let's say the selfie generation or people following the X Factor way of doing things. There are a lot of people that want fame for fame's sake, and a lot of that is to do fame, power, money. But that's not true art. We know that. I think we can all tell the difference between that. And, you know, it's pretty healthy. There's enough people out there that feel strongly about what they're doing. And as I keep going back to it, there's a lot more of a platform now. And if that does kind of apply itself to being DIY, I mean, well, whatever. It's you can be heard. I think the driving force is do it because you love it or you feel you need to do it. That's the reality for me.
To leave things on a positive and an inspiring note, but still in a realistic way, how art pushes people together. We all agree on this. This is how we ended up here all together on this stage today. Moving forward, how can we, if we're gonna talk about the unfair balance or unfair distribution of money and power within the music industry, that still 100% agree with you exists. But with the tools that we have access to now within our means, how can we still form coalitions to challenge these indifferences? How can we do that?
Well, I think, you know, I from the place that I'm in, I view as there being all these kind of, I view them almost like militias, all these sort of small crews or groups of people who are doing stuff that is maybe complementary, but really interesting. And the internet is able to like magnify the social, the awareness of them socially, their social currency. So I just try and support all of these militias. I try and join them up. I try and like all these people, you know, who are doing something cool. And they, you know, if I get any resources, I try and share them. I feel like it's just people, and they're just at the end of a button. You know, instead of all the artists watching each other and trying to compete, because this is what happens, artists try and compete. We shouldn't do that. Let's actually support each other and look at, like, really who, what, you know, look at what it is we're trying to do, what we're trying to change, and who we need to get past in order to change that. And it's not each other. So, yeah, I think it's super possible. Just go on Twitter. Oh, I rate this person. I think they're sick. Just cold call them. Email them out the blue. That's what I do. People think I'm weird for it, but I don't care. Because it's like, if not us, then who, right? We're just waiting for somebody who, like, I'm not going to mention no names, yeah, but we're waiting for somebody who works at this place to, like, go through your friends list and do that on behalf of this organization and then put you together in a room and try and take credit for when you already knew each other. No, just do it. Let's do it ourselves, you know, as you say.
I think something I found to be super empowering in terms of not necessarily creating coalition, but creating positive change is, like, I can only speak from experience, but a question I get asked a lot is, like, what's it like to be a female DJ? And, like, I mean, why are you asking me? Like, ask promoters, ask booking agencies, ask management companies, why don't they have more women on their roster? Why don't they have more non-white cis males on their roster? You know, so to kind of, like, re-ask questions that we're asked as artists in a position of power to the people who are actually in the positions of power has been more interesting and effective than trying to kind of come up with like a politically correct answer, because that's a stupid question.
And that's what you said before as well. We're fighting the wrong people. Yeah.
Like, just, you know, we're just busy engaged with, like, I don't know, like, everybody watching their own corner. And it's like, maybe because I came to being an artist fairly late on, I don't have that sense of, like, I'm a fan, like, of stuff. And I feel like, let's come together and, as you say, like challenge the authority, which whose interest is to keep us apart. Because once we're apart, right, you can use us for profit. And I'm a big believer in commerce, but not for profit. You know what I mean? Like trade for the betterment of everybody rather than the profit of a small number of people. So let's, you know, people who's watching this, you've got your demo, send it to me. Like, do you know what I mean?
There you go. Guys, that's unfortunately all our time today. I want to thank you all for coming. Can I get a massive applause for these panelists? And thank you guys all for being here.